Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Live to 110 podcast. My name is Wendy Myers, and I'm a certified holistic health and nutrition coach. We're broadcasting live from Malibu, California, and today I'm going to be interviewing Paul Jaminet of perfecthealthdiet.com about his fantastic book, The Perfect Health Diet, Naturally. Dr. Jaminet and his wife have collaborated for many years on their book on what they think is the perfect diet for optimum health. And it is a paleo or ancestral-based diet, but it's tweaked based upon their extensive research and dietary knowledge. But before we get started, I have to do a little disclaimer. Please keep in mind that this program is not intended to diagnose or treat any disease or health condition. The Live to 110 podcast is solely informational in nature. Please consult your healthcare practitioner before engaging in any treatment I suggest on this show. And please go check out my website, livetoo110.com. I started this site to educate you about paleo nutrition and the importance of detoxing from heavy metals and industrial chemicals that I believe are the major underlying cause of disease, and how to treat your health conditions naturally without medication. And my goal with livetoo110.com is to help you prevent disease and live a long, healthy life. And if you like what you hear on today's show, please give the podcast a nice review and rating in iTunes. This will help people around the world to find the show easier and get my word out on health. I would really appreciate it a lot. Now, let's get on with the show. Good afternoon, Paul. How are you?
Very good, Wendy. It's great to be with you.
Yeah, thank you so much for being on the show. And first, why don't you tell the listeners a little bit about yourself?
Well, I've had sort of a checkered career. I started out as an astrophysicist, and so I had an 11-year career in science at MIT, UC Berkeley, and Harvard. But I got a little bored with science, and during the internet boom, I decided to jump into the software industry and did a couple of startups. And when the company I had co-founded moved to California, I stayed here. My wife is a scientist at Harvard Medical School, and decided to start do something I'd always wanted to do, write some books. But I'd had some chronic health problems, and they seemed to keep getting worse. And I noticed that my productivity wasn't good. I was having neurological issues, memory loss, and I just wasn't being very productive. So my focus shifted a little to figuring out my health, and started making progress after we discovered the paleo diet in 2005, and that had some good effects, but also some bad effects, and it needed refinement. And we've basically spent the last 8 years figuring out how to improve paleo and make it better. And we fixed our own health problems around 2010 and decided we knew enough to share it with others. So we wrote our book, and we've had thousands of readers report great results. And so that's basically our history. So now we're just trying to share what we've learned and help other people become healthy.
Yeah, that's great, and I love reading your book as well, because I totally identify with what you're trying to do with the book is, you know, start with a paleo-based diet, but add in new foods that, you know, maybe the cavemen didn't eat, but that we have absolutely adapted to and are incredibly nutritious. You know, it's foolish to think we can't adapt to eating new foods. And so what are the foundations or the tenets of the Perfect Health Diet?
Well, I would say the first and most important thing is it's a natural whole foods diet. So processed foods in the supermarket, have sort of a triple whammy of ill health. They tend to be, made of purified ingredients, so they lack a lot of nutrition. They tend to be pulled from the most toxic foods, and the manner in which they're prepared in factories uses a lot of high heat and pressure, which creates more toxins. So they tend to be nutrient poor, toxin rich. And so it's very desirable to shop around the edges of the supermarket, get natural whole foods, cook for yourself at home using natural cooking methods. And then our goal is basically to create a diet that's free of toxins and that is optimally nourishing. So it's a balanced diet that gives you the optimal amount of every nutrient. And so in the book, we go through, you know, all the or a great many of the nutrients that humans need and figure out how much we need and think about, you know, what foods, what mix of foods we should eat in order to get optimal nutrition. And it works out to, you know, maybe 3/4 to a pound of meat or fish per day, about a pound of what we call safe starches, about a pound of sugary plant foods, and about another pound of vegetables. You know, so basically roughly 3 pounds of plant foods, 1 pound of animal foods a day. You know, by weight, but most of the calories end up coming from the animal foods and from healthy fats that you use to flavor things. We recommend a lot of what we call supplemental foods that are rich in specific nutrients that you need. So things like liver, egg yolks, seafood of all kinds, seaweed, shellfish, and oily marine fish like salmon are valuable to include in the diet. Fermented vegetables, bone, you know, stocks and stews made from bones and joints are very good sources of both calcium and collagen. And collagen is extremely important to get in the diet. So there's a, you know, pretty broad range of nutritious foods that we make a point of persuading people to eat. And in general, I would call our diet, you know, balanced and moderate. You know, people often tell you to eat a balanced diet, but, you know, what does that mean? And, you know, so we try to figure out what that is. And, you know, so we recommend a little bit more in carbohydrates than the average paleo dieter eats. But on the other hand, it's, you know, only half to 2/3 as many carbohydrates as the average American eats. So it's a, you know, in some ways our diet resembles classic gourmet cuisines like classic French cooking or classic Chinese cuisine. A lot of Asian cuisines are very similar to the Perfect Health Diet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I noticed that, you know, the basic foundation of the diet is like a paleo or ancestral type diet, but you modernized it by and improved it by including dairy and starches like rice and potatoes. Why is that?
Well, first of all, you know, there's sort of an historical reasons in how we developed it. So I mentioned that my wife and I had problems on paleo when we first tried it, and I had problems from being too low carb. So I was excluding starches, and I developed dry eyes, dry mouth, hypothyroid symptoms, and other problems, and you know, some gut problems and other things. And I ultimately realized that I needed more carbohydrates, and I just, you know, felt a lot better if I was getting carbohydrates in the diet. And then as we did more research, we realized that, you know, the body really has a significant need for dietary glucose. And, you know, so it's valuable to nourish yourself with some starches. And there really aren't, it's only once you eat so much that you exceed your body's need for glucose and the body has to dispose of it that you start running into problems. And that's generally over about a 30% carb diet. You know, so even diabetics can eat a 20% carb diet generally quite well. You know, so partly in that case, it was personal experience. In other cases, it's been, you know, research-oriented or based on, in a few cases, some feedback from readers have led us to investigate the literature more deeply and adjust our recommendations a little. But basically what's interesting is we found that, when you bring that paleo perspective and an evolutionary perspective, then a lot of the data in the literature starts to make a lot more sense. It's, there's usually ways to interpret things that are different from the way the authors of papers interpret them. And when you look at their data, the great majority of the data actually points toward a diet like ours. And, so that was really a pleasing thing to find as we did our research. And it was also very pleasing that, the more we learned and the more we adjusted the diet, the more we kept getting led back to gourmet traditional cuisines. Like I mentioned, French and Thai and Chinese and Japanese cuisine. And in retrospect, that makes a lot of sense. We didn't realize it at the time, but the reward system of the human brain has evolved and make healthy food taste delicious to us. And so if you're eating a natural whole foods diet, then the meals that taste great will generally be the healthiest ones. It's very pleasing that we ended up in a place where all the evidence seems to point in the same direction and to be supportive of our diet.
Yeah, absolutely. And do you think that there's something to be said for some people need more starches than others? That's kind of an individual thing. Like some people that, I've listened to said they do better with their weight or whatnot, doing less starches and less grains, and others need a lot more.
Well, there are some variations, but I would say that most of the variations are due to, things like different gut bacteria and gut flora, or to health conditions like, various illnesses like diabetes or bowel disease. And in general, I would say 30% carbs is really optimal for everybody. It's optimal for the human body. But some people have, genetic disorders and glucose metabolism, and that usually shows up in the brain. So those people may want to switch to a ketogenic diet, which tends to be lower carb. And we've had, dozens of people cure their migraines by switching to a ketogenic diet. So I would say that's very common, some sort of genetic disorders that affect glucose metabolism. And then, but the biggest factor that makes people have trouble with carbs is some kind of gut dysbiosis. And the carbohydrates feed whatever infectious pathogens they have in their gut. And they get a big influx of toxins from the microbial activity, and they feel lousy. But the solution there isn't to never eat carbs for the rest of your life. It's to fix the gut problem, and restore normal gut flora, and then you'll be able to eat carbohydrates. So there are some individual differences, but I would say that the fundamental biology of people is pretty similar. A few people have genetic mutations which have an impact, but usually they don't make a dramatic change in how you should eat. It's more of tweaking things. Gut flora problems can have significant effects, creating food sensitivities or, problems with carbohydrates.
Yeah, that's a big problem today in our society. People are eating so much sugar and wheat and whatnot that the pathogenic bacteria are exploding in people's intestines. And so what about dairy? You include dairy on the Perfect Health Diet. Can you explain that, why you included that?
Well, it's a... dairy is a little tricky because it's such a complicated food, You know, it has to be so that milk can have everything that an infant needs. So it's, you know, it's a little bit hard to analyze. There's various issues with it. On the good side, the nutrient composition is just about perfect. So, and the fatty acid profile is just about perfect for us. So, you know, just like it's the perfect food for infants, it's still an extremely good food for adults in terms of its nutrient content. And, you know, so it would be a shame to give that up. Now, the basic potential problems are cross-species proteins. So we can, many mammalian proteins will be bioactive in us, but yet they're foreign and we can have sensitivities and so on to them, and they may not match our biology that well. So it's not uncommon to have sensitivities to casein, one of the proteins in dairy, if it's not properly digested. And pasteurized milk seems to make it hard to digest. You know, then it can have various hormones and other things. And then milk can also carry infectious disease. And it's possible that pasteurization may not entirely kill all pathogens. So, you know, they're sort of mixed, you know, and people don't cook milk when they get it home. So there's various, you know, pros and cons to milk. And in general, the fatty parts of milk, you know, like butter, is extremely good for us. You know, most of the problematic parts of milk are more water soluble, or, you know, they're in white blood cells or other things that are in the milk if the cow had an infection or something. So, you know, something like butter, especially clarified butter or ghee, is good. And fermented dairy is generally quite good because bacteria break down toxins and other harmful things when they ferment. And so things like yogurt and aged cheese are generally quite healthy. So, you know, so we tend to recommend fermented and fatty dairy foods and recommend against drinking milk.
Oh, really?
Yeah, are you a proponent of raw dairy?
Well, it's, again, it has pros and cons. It's definitely more digestible, more nourishing. But on the other hand, there is an infectious disease risk. And you know, so the farmer has to be extremely careful. And you should get, you know, because it's very easy for the udder to be contaminated with feces and so on. And so it's a, you know, it's kind of a judgment call.
Yeah. I love that you said that butter is really nutritious, because it kills me whenever I go to a client's home and everyone has margarine in their refrigerator, and like everyone has vilified butter and that it's bad, and their doctors have told them to avoid it because of high cholesterol. Can you shed a little bit of light on that myth?
Yeah, well, margarine is awful, and butter is, you know, just about the perfect fat, especially if it's clarified butter. So it's, you know, there was a lot of prejudice against saturated fats, and that's largely disappeared because, you know, with another 20 years of research, people realized that none of it panned out. And actually, in clinical trials, saturated fat always does as well or better than other kinds of fat or than carbohydrates. And there was a lot of testing of those, especially the polyunsaturated fats, because when the lipid hypothesis was big, everybody assumed that if you replace saturated fats with polyunsaturated fats, it had been shown that that could lower cholesterol levels. And everybody figured, oh, if we lower cholesterol levels, then we'll have fewer heart attacks. And so they made these clinical trials where they replaced saturated fat with polyunsaturated fat. And in nearly all of them, the death rate went up substantially in the polyunsaturated fat group. And so, and in retrospect, you know, people had done some epidemiological studies which seemed to suggest saturated fat might be bad, and those have, with better, with more data, we found that those correlations disappeared or reversed. And then people made improper inferences from a bunch of, you know, really short-term studies, like the response to a single meal. And, you know, seeing an inflammatory response to a single meal. But if you're changing your diet, you know, people are eating one diet and you give them a totally different set of food, then the short-term response doesn't indicate the long-term helpfulness. So there were just a lot of mistaken inferences, and generally speaking, you know, what we've learned is that saturated fats are really extremely good for intracellular health. They make your mitochondria very healthy, your cells very healthy, and that's sort of a foundation for general health. The short-term negative effects are, you know, saturated fats help cells, you know, push out things they don't want into the blood, and then the body has to deal with that. So there's a little bit of dynamics there, but actually over time, saturated fats will generally make people healthier.
Yeah, I've also read that you need saturated fats in the diet to absorb minerals into your bones as well.
Well, you know, saturated fats make up like 45% or so of all the fats in the body. And they're also building blocks for making cholesterol and other lipids, and for making important hormones, the sterol hormones, things like vitamin D and related things, testosterone. You know, they're definitely nourishing. And when people eat lipid-deficient diets, like the macrobiotic diet, then they often get into situations where their body is really starved for these fats with negative health effects.
Yeah, and what about with red meat or any kind of meats with saturated fats? Are those, you obviously need to be eating those for health as well, right?
Yeah, that's right. So we recommend making ruminant meats like beef, lamb. Oops, sorry about that. Beef, lamb, goat. As a cornerstone of your diet, plus fish and seafood. So in general, anything, any animal where the food chain is built on something green, like you know, green grasses in the case of cows, or algae in the case of seafood, is going to be the healthiest food for us. And the animals whose food chain is based on nuts and seeds tend to be less healthy for us. Mm-hmm. So in general, the red meat items are quite good for us. The one possible exception is pork. And a lot of the pork animals carry infections. And so I would recommend not eating pork liver, pork blood, pork intestines, and also cooking other cuts of pork thoroughly. So, you know, it's probably good to simmer them for 20 minutes or something in order to make sure you've killed any pathogens that might have infected that pig.
Yeah, I read something interesting the other day that bacon is the most nutritious part of the pig. Is that, do you find that to be the case?
Well, I wouldn't say that, but it's a benign and relatively safe. It's among the safest parts of the pig.
Okay. Yeah, I was really excited when I learned that. I really like bacon, but even I'm worried about eating it though, because there is, you know, the parasitic infection issues with pigs. But Can you tell me about your knowledge about the history of the hybridization or breeding of beef and how this affects the quality of the meat?
Well, I'm not an expert on the history of cattle breeding. So you may be thinking about the different types of milk and the different types of caseins in animals. So it seems like, some people may be extra sensitive to, certain breeds of cow. There's also such a thing as a beef allergy, which has turned out to be due to it's actually a tick allergy, but the antibodies to the tick can cross-react with beef. But nearly everybody who has that continues eating beef, so I guess it's not that severe. The casein problem, which creates sensitivities to milk, that's really dependent on poor digestion. So if people's digestion is working well, then they won't really have that sensitivity. So those kinds of sensitivities are usually diagnostic for some kind of digestive issue.
Okay. So what foods do you think are particularly nutritious and should be included in one's diet?
Well, I would say liver is extremely important. It has a lot of nutrients that many of which it's very hard to get elsewhere. And if you just include a quarter pound of liver per week in your diet, then a lot of nutritional issues will often go away. And then another key one is egg yolks. And we recommend including 3 egg yolks a day in your cooking. You can eat the egg whites also, but egg sensitivities are pretty common. And also, the egg white doesn't have much nutrition. So you can actually increase the nutrient density of your diet if you discard the egg whites and eat more meat to get that protein. And just eat the egg yolks, and you can avoid
sensitivity. Funny, that's the exact opposite of what, so many trainers or so many people think is common knowledge. So eat the egg yolks and not the whites.
Yeah, that's another, mistake back from the, back from cholesterol phobia. Yep, it's the egg white is basically just protein. Not very many people are deficient in protein. It's pretty easy to find meat or fish to give you enough protein.
So can you bypass the sensitivity issues that many people have with eggs by just eating the yolks?
Yeah, so first of all, most of the sensitivity is generally to proteins in the white. So if you discard the white, you're reducing your odds of a sensitivity by 80-90%. And then the other thing to do is to cook the white. So I would recommend mixing it in with something like, coconut milk or something else in some kind of dish, a soup or a stew or something, and then cooking it. And the cooked yolk proteins are much more easily digested. So in one study, the raw proteins were only 54% digested, but the cooked ones were 93% digested. Mm-hmm. And, so if you cook them, then you're reducing your chances of a sensitivity by 90% again. So just those two steps, discarding the white and cooking the yolks, are probably reducing, any sort of sensitivity reaction by 95% or maybe more. And so that will generally prevent any sensitivity from developing in the first place. And then as long as you heal up your digestive tract, the sensitivity will go away. So, as long as you're not, you just don't want to introduce lots of those undigested proteins into your body, because then you'll keep generating more antibodies. If you can cook them enough so that you reduce the influx and then heal your gut, then the antibodies will go away and the sensitivity will go away.
Yeah, and what are some of the other foods that you think are really nutritious that people should be eating every day?
Yeah, well, seafood is really important. Shellfish has a lot of nutrition. We recommend one meal a week of an oily marine fish like salmon, sardines. We recommend eating seaweeds, which have a lot of valuable minerals. We recommend fermented vegetables. So fermented foods have a lot of certain nutrients that are hard to get otherwise, like vitamin K2, vitamin B12, nucleotides. So there's phospholipids. So there's various useful things there. And they also make the vegetables more digestible, so you get a lot of vegetable nutrition. And you get a lot of probiotic bacteria. So a lot of, you want to ferment vegetables, in a fermenting chamber that creates an environment similar to our colon. And that way you'll generate a lot of beneficial bacteria. And then finally I would say you need collagen. So you should have lots of connective tissue and some bones in your diet, and you should simmer them for quite a while to render them digestible and solubilize minerals from the bone. And, so if you make soups and stews out of bone and joint and connective tissue material, so it's good to buy beef tendon, it's good to buy chicken feed, ox hooves, oxtail, bones that you can use for making soups and stews. And so we always have, some sets of food preparing, vegetables fermenting. We always have bones and joint material around we make a stock. So after we cook dinner, we can, put some bones on the stove and, simmer them for 3 hours, and then we've got a stock that we can use for cooking the next few days.
Yeah, I have gotten in the habit of making chicken broth, at least once a week, and I just have a little cup every morning. I think a lot of people don't realize, especially if they have a degenerative joint issues or arthritis, that they need that collagen to repair their joints. Essential.
Yeah, right. So collagen supplements are really well attested, but if you go to the store and look at the price of the supplements, it's like, this tiny amount is, $30-$40, whereas you can get, joint material, collagen-rich material, extremely, for $3 a pound at the butcher, and just cook it yourself, and it's extremely important. So collagen is 30% of all the protein in your body. Basically, this extracellular matrix material is 30% of your body weight, just about. And it's constantly breaking down, and you need to provide the nutrients to replenish it. And often people get chronic infections. This was one of my problems, where the extracellular matrix is getting broken down by the infection, and you need to constantly repair it. And so you need extra collagen, extra vitamin C, and some other nutrients, and you need carbohydrates. It's important to get collagen in your diet. It makes a difference.
Yeah, and that bone broth is also extremely mineral rich as well. You're leaching all those minerals from the bones, and just an incredibly nutritious food. So, what foods do you advocate eliminating from the diet?
Well, most of the standard paleo items, like cereal grains, legumes, added sugar, and vegetable seed oils that are high in omega-6. And so definitely cutting down omega-6 fats is a major, major point of emphasis for our diet. You really need very little omega-6 in your diet. 2% to 3% of energy is optimal. And there's really big negative effects to eating omega-6 fats beyond about 4% of energy. and the average American is eating 9%. So, you know, that's, I'd say that's one of the major problems with the American diet, and it's also a major reason why U.S. life expectancy is about 4 years shorter than most of Europe or East Asia. There really isn't that much difference in our diet, apart from we have higher omega-6 intake from vegetable oils. So the grains and legumes, the reason for that is basically grasses co-evolved with mammals. Herbivorous mammals have been grazing on cereal grains and legumes for 50 million years. And these grains and legumes have evolved toxins in their seeds to prevent mammalian digestion from working. And those toxins work against us. And if they get into the body, they work not only against their digestive tract, but against all of our other organs, too. And there's a lot of evidence for grains and legumes causing problems. And, you know, so many people have improved their health by going on gluten-free diets, which get rid of the most dangerous grain toxins. There are also plenty of studies relating to legumes. There was just a study out that people who ate tofu regularly had a much higher risk for cognitive impairment and brain atrophy 20 years later. So,
yeah, I had a really unfortunate thing happen with that. And I went vegetarian right after I had my daughter. And at about 1 year old, I started stuffing her full of tofu. I had this brilliant idea that she was going to get her healthy beans. Because, you know, vegetarian diet, the basis of it is beans for protein. And I started feeding her tofu every single day. And she has a one-year speech delay. And I think that definitely has part responsible. And additionally, you know, soy's, if it's fed to children, it can give them manganese toxicity as well. It's just real nasty. Soy is so nasty.
Yeah, manganese is a neurotoxin too. So, yeah, it's unfortunate. Hopefully she'll fully recover. And, you know, if she's eating well now, then, you know, the body has great healing powers. And, you know, so it should normalize itself.
Yeah, I'm hopeful it will. She's definitely no more soy, and she's on definitely a paleo diet, so she'll be fine.
Yep. All right. So probably the biggest difference in regard to the grains and legumes from other paleo diets is we recommend including white rice, and it basically gets back to the fundamental principle of our diet. We're trying to eliminate toxins and provide an optimal amount of nutrition. And white rice is unique among the grains in that all the known toxins in rice are destroyed during cooking. And you can destroy many of the other grain toxins if you cook them for a long time in simmering water. But, you know, nobody likes to have soggy spaghetti. You know, but white rice, the normal cooking of white rice destroys its toxins, and, you know, so it's a quite safe food. And you know, we don't want to exclude foods unnecessarily. And like I said before, glucose is a nutrient. So, you know, white rice, even though it's not nutrient-rich, it does have some nutrition. And it's certainly a very convenient food.
Yeah, that's really interesting that you're saying that white rice you should be eating instead of brown rice. We've been told forever that brown rice is healthier than white rice.
Yeah, I don't think so. It's the bran has most of the protein and most of the toxins, and so if you mill off the bran, you're actually making cereal grain safer. And, you know, some authorities recommend eating the bran because of fiber, but actually in clinical trials where they give grain fiber to people. The people who get the grain fiber always end up with worse health. And so, and that makes sense because the beneficial kinds of fiber are actually the ones in fruits and vegetables, or they're a kind called resistant starch, which is not what's in the bran. So resistant starch is most common actually in potatoes and tubers, root, starchy root vegetables and storage organs. So it's actually very good to eat potatoes and fruits and vegetables and get the fiber in those, but you don't want to get fiber from whole grains.
So what are some of the problems with other types of grains, like gluten-containing grains, for instance?
Well, wheat has a lot of negative effects. It's now it seems like people whose ancestors have been eating wheat for thousands of years have adapted somewhat and are better at detoxifying them. So it seems like the negative effects of wheat show up most strongly in like Aboriginal populations or people who haven't don't have a long history of agriculture. But even in Europeans, there's a lot of people with gluten sensitivity, and there may be insidious effects from various wheat toxins. So there was a study last year in Japan where they looked at children who routinely, they compared children who routinely eat wheat versus children who routinely eat rice. So rice is the traditional food in Japan, but wheat has been making inroads. And it turned out that the children who ate wheat had lower IQs and signs of brain damage on MRIs compared to the children who ate rice. And their IQs were like 3.4 points lower. So, there's other similar evidence. Like in China, there are wheat-growing regions and rice-growing regions. And in the China study, they compiled a lot of health data from, I think it was 829 Chinese provinces. And it turned out the strongest correlation with good health was eating rice, and the strongest correlation with bad health was eating wheat. So if rice is significantly better than wheat, that's exactly the pattern that you'd expect, because those are staple foods in different regions. People are eating a lot of them, so they have a big impact, and they show up high in the correlation studies. So, likewise, when you look at wheat-eating countries versus rice-eating countries, like compare East Asia to America and Europe. Generally speaking, the more wheat people eat, the shorter the life expectancy in that country. The more they use rice, the longer the life expectancy. So there's a lot of hints that that rice is safer than wheat, that wheat has, it does harm. But it's really hard to, it's really hard to conclusively prove the negative effects when, it takes 50, 60, 70 years for the negative effects to show up.
Yeah.
If weed is shortening your lifespan by 3 or 4 years, and it's just, gradually breaking down bodily functions, but it's very hard to do an experiment, where you can observe an effect that takes 70 years to show up.
Yeah, and so what are some of the problems with legumes? Like what problems do beans pose in the diet?
Well, they're very similar biologically to grains. So they evolved a lot of toxins to suppress mammalian digestion. And, those can cause great harm. In many of them, just eating a small amount of beans raw can be fatal. And we mentioned a few cases like that in the book. And raw beans will kill rats or mice very quickly. So now cooking destroys many of the toxins. But in order to really reduce the toxin load from beans, what you need to do is soak them for like 24 hours to start the germination process. That really cuts down the toxin load, and then you need to cook them thoroughly. So it's basically, you know, like traditional Indian cooking, you know, where they soak the beans for 24 hours and then they simmer them in a curry for 6 hours and really long cooking times. And you know, so they can be made safe, or most beans can, but nobody cooks that way nowadays. Certainly industrial food producers don't. And, you know, in factories, they're trying to get the food in and out through the factory as quickly as they can. And so they're quite toxin rich. And we generally just recommend avoiding them.
Okay. And so a lot of people think that soy is healthy, yet you exclude it from the perfect health diet. And I completely agree with excluding it from the diet for so many reasons. And can you explain some of your detailed reasons for why you recommend avoiding soy?
Well, we've talked about some of them. It does have a lot of toxins, toxins that act on digestion. It has, I mentioned the tofu study where it led to cognitive decline. Soy is one of the most common food sensitivities. And in fact, probably the majority of people that have egg sensitivities are actually sensitive to soy proteins in the eggs because chickens are usually fed soy to give them protein. And then soy also has huge effects on reproductive function in both men and women. So it tends to impair sperm quality in men. It's associated with uterine fibroids and endometriosis in women. It has various phytoestrogens and other things with hormonal activity. So there's a lot of potential issues with soy. Also, the oil, soybean oil, is majority omega-6 fat, and so that really contributes to the omega-6 problem that I mentioned. So there's a lot of reasons for avoiding soy.
Yeah, and I had someone complain about, I have a blog post on my site about soy, vilifying soy, and the commenter was complaining that the phytoestrogens in soy are very actually weak and that they don't affect our estrogen receptors very well. What do you think about that?
Well, they are weak as estrogens, but I think there's reason to believe that they have significant effects. So, you know, for instance, my wife ate a lot of soy for a long time and developed uterine fibroids and endometriosis. And, you know, that association is very common. And I don't think it's necessarily due to the phytoestrogens. I think it's probably other toxins are more relevant. You know, I think like I said, the fundamental issue is, you know, these plants have been getting eaten by mammals for tens of millions of years. So, you know, unlike vegetables where their big threat is insects and germs, and they make a lot of toxins, but they're not that toxic to us. These are plants that have been making toxins specifically for mammals. And they act very specifically on our biology and disrupt our biology. And they're intended to prevent our digestive tracts from digesting food. And genes are shared by all the organs. So anything that's powerful enough to stop our intestine from digesting food is also powerful enough to disrupt the function of other organs. And so I don't really see a good reason for eating these foods. Their fatty acid composition is bad. Their proteins are toxic to us. You know, there's plenty of good protein sources in meat and fish. So, and even if you're a vegetarian, I'd recommend you eat dairy and eggs to get protein. So you can eat yogurt and eggs, be a lacto-ovo vegetarian. you know, so I just don't see anything positive about soy to make it worth taking the risk.
Yeah, it's really sad that there's such an escalating problem with infertility in the United States. And I think it's directly or definitely correlated with soy because we get a lot of soy. We get so much more soy. We're ingesting so much more of it than we realize because it's in everything. It's in filler in fast foods. It's a filler in vegetarian products and foods. It's Asian restaurants, so the food is cooked in it. It's just everywhere. So it's definitely something to be wary of.
Yeah, it's, of course, it's one of the subsidized crops in the United States, and it's just the cheapest, one of the cheapest raw materials for food producers, and they use it everywhere.
So, Paul, thank you so much for being on the show, and that was just so informative. And can you tell the listeners a little bit about your Perfect Health retreats? I think it's really interesting that you have this retreat that people can go there and they can learn and, you know, eat your diet and start incorporating the principles into their lives.
Yeah, well, we wanted to make it easier for people to figure out how to, for people to learn our program. You know, actually, we have a lot more than diet. We also have lifestyle advice in regard to circadian rhythms, intermittent fasting, enhancing immunity, how to overcome chronic infections. And if people go to our website, perfecthealthdiet.com, and look at our reader results page, you know, they'll see we've got our readers have reported cures of, you know, like hundreds of conditions. And we think that makes sense because, you know, we're basically trying to address every single factor that impairs health and remove all the causes of disease. So if we get rid of toxins from your diet, if we nourish your body optimally, if we give your body the right environmental stimulation and support immune function optimally, then it should have the best possible chance to overcome whatever is causing diseases. And so, but we still want to learn exactly what we can cure, and we want to help people cure their own diseases because so many people are not getting help from medicine. And so we started up this Perfect Health Retreat program. It's at an upscale property in Austin, Texas. And basically all of your food is provided for 30 days. You get a 30-day educational program of talks and so on. There's a resident trainer with an exercise program, including yoga instructors, primal seven movements. There's a gym membership. There's there are classes in cooking and gardening, hunting, fishing. It's just a extensive program, you know, helping you learn how to cook, how to eat, how to shop for food, how to live your life optimally. And so we give people, you know, an optimal diet and lifestyle for 30 days so that they can see the effects in their body. And we also train them in everything they need to know, understanding the science behind everything, you know, so that they'll be able to live out the diet and lifestyle when they go back home. And so far, at least, it's had, you know, tremendous results. We've had like 10 participants so far, and every one of them has had tremendous health improvements. And the variety of conditions is great. We've had four obese people who have lost tremendous amounts of weight. One fellow who's there now has lost 21 pounds in less than a month.
Oh, wow. I'm going there.
We've had several diabetics who normalized their blood sugar. We've had a woman with Sjogren's syndrome who is now able to cry, and a woman with lupus who's recovered a great deal. We had a woman with Sjogren's syndrome had to walk with a cane, and everybody who is on sleep, who is on pain medication has given up all of their pain medication because their pain is gone. And, you know, so she was walking with a cane and had been scheduled for knee and hip surgery and doesn't need the surgery and is now walking pain-free. So, you know, it's exciting because I think, you know, we have a chance to prove with an unbiased sample, you know, we see everybody, we see their results. And so if there are any negative results, we'll see those too. We haven't had any yet, but, and hopefully we won't, but, you know, and that's good because, you know, people just don't believe reader results reported to a website because they don't know if it's a biased sample, if, you know, some people had negative results and didn't report it. And this is a really good test because, you know, at the retreat house, we're providing the food. It's a, you know, controlled environment. There are, you know, bright lights during the day, dim amber lights at night, you know, for circadian rhythm purposes. There's, you know, so we provide exercise at the right, you know, opportunities at the right circadian times. You know, so people, it really is a, you know, a good test. And you know, everything is optimized, and it really seems to be working for everybody who's gone so far.
Yeah, it's really a testament to using food as medicine, that when you nourish the body properly, it can heal itself as powerful regenerative capacities.
Yeah, that's right. I think, you know, diet and lifestyle are really crucial. Diet, nutrition, lifestyle.
So, Paul, what projects do you have on the horizon? What are you up to these days?
Well, I'm working on preparing and improving the educational materials for the Perfect Health Retreats, and ultimately we're going to make videos out of them, and so we may have a video product eventually, and my wife and I are working on a cookbook. And then I'm also working with the Ancestral Health Society to create a scholarly journal called the Journal of Evolution and Health. And we'll be launching that pretty soon. And that's a very exciting project because we can hopefully, it can be a forum for us to reach out and show the benefits of ancestral diet and lifestyle. You know, to the medical community, to the academic, scientific community, and I'm really looking forward to promoting that conversation and, you know, compiling the evidence that, you know, diet and lifestyle can really be effective in healing.
Yeah, I'm really excited to see what comes out of that journal because it's, you know, it can be difficult to find, you know, studies and peer-reviewed research and whatnot on the benefits of eating grass-fed meat and eating an ancestral diet. So I'm really hungry for more information on those subjects.
Yeah, I think, you know, I think the journal can really be a focal point for bringing everybody who's interested in natural healing approaches and, you know, synthesizing all the knowledge and experience we have with the best science and the best research and engaging with other people who are outside the ancestral lifestyle and, you know, exposing them to what we've learned and bringing more people into the community. So, you know, I think it's potentially a very exciting project.
Yeah, well, Paul, thank you so much for being on the show. And everyone, please take a peek at his amazingly informative website, perfecthealthdiet.com. And he's got an incredible blog, supplement recommendations, recipes, and, of course, more information on his book, The Perfect Health Diet. So, again, Paul, thank you for being on the show.
Okay, thank you very much, Wendy.
Thank you. So next week, I'll be interviewing fellow podcaster Beverly Meyer on how to optimize your feel-good neurotransmitters like serotonin and dopamine without supplements or antidepressant medication. And it's a big issue because 10% of the population is on antidepressant medication, and it's kind of be the wrong approach for many people, since studies do show that antidepressants typically work by the placebo effect. And it's just you need to start thinking about natural approaches like diet and maybe some targeted supplementation. So everyone, thank you so much out there to all the listeners for tuning in to the Lived 110 podcast. Please remember to leave a review on iTunes if you enjoy what you heard today on the show. And thank you so much for listening. Bye-bye.